Good morning. Yes, it is. We received a postcard from Kevin and Imelda that I would like to share with you. Okay, there's a picture on the front. I don't know what it is. It's an architecture of something. It doesn't say, or if it does, it's too small for me to read.
Maybe a church. They have a lot of old churches in Mexico.
Yeah, I don't know what it is. I can't read it. But on the back, I can read. And it says, "Hello, brothers and sisters. Thank you so much for sharing in our ministry. Your prayers and financial support are more of a blessing than you know. We hope to see you in September. God bless. Kevin, Imelda, Mila, Alexandra, and Ariana." I spoke with Kevin this last week. They are planning on being here. Their plane arrives the last part of August. They will be in service with us. We know for sure the first Sunday in September. Kevin will be sharing with us the things that God has shown them and what they have done for the last year in Mexico. So they will be here in September for sure.
Glenn?
Yes, sir.
Just so people remember, underneath the world map over there,
we've
been posting, Shelley has been posting updates from people, and we just put one of Kevin and Imelda's updates up there this morning. So
yes,
don't forget about that stuff.
And keep an eye on that, because there's not really a schedule as to when we receive those. Whenever they post one, Shelley is faithful to get it printed off and put it up there so you guys can see what's been going on with the different missionaries that we support. All right, if you have your Bibles, which you should, open to Hebrews chapter 6. If not, there are Bibles in front of you. Hebrews chapter 6. We have been talking about discipleship, and we've kind of covered the calling of a disciple. Now we're going over the basic doctrines, the elemental truths of our faith. And we're starting with what the Bible says are the basic truths. Okay? So, starting in verse 1, actually I'm going to back up, because in order to understand verse 1, you need to know what came before. So I'm backing up to chapter 5, verse 11. The writer of Hebrews is talking about Jesus being a high priest after the order of Melchizedek. Okay, this is important because the high priest came from the lineage of Levi and the offspring of... good Lord. Come on, Moses' brother.
Aaron.
Aaron! I was stuck on Abraham. And I knew it wasn't Abraham. Aaron. So the Aaronic priesthood. And the writer saying, well, Jesus has come to be high priest, but not of the order of Aaron, but of the order of Melchizedek. And he says, about this, we have much to say, and it is hard to explain, since you have become dull of hearing. I want to pause there for just a minute, because this is a warning to all of us. Okay? We grow comfortable and complacent with the regularity of our faith. And we get to the point where we start to do things by rote. Okay? Where we do them just because they become a habit, and we don't really pay attention to what we're doing. For example, singing the songs this morning. Okay? That could have been a beautiful moment of worship. Or it could have been singing songs. It depends on where your heart and your mind were in that particular moment. See, we grow so comfortable with the certain things, the familiarity of certain things, that we tend to neglect what they really are. And throughout Scripture, we see this reflected in being called dull of hearing or hard of hearing. Okay? So this is a caution to all of us today. Be on your guard that you don't become dull of hearing. Verse 12. For though by this time you ought to be teachers, you need someone to teach you again the basic principles of the oracles of God. Now I want to clarify something right here. We attended a church for a time when we were younger that took this passage to mean that everybody should teach. I do not subscribe to that. I think Scripture is very clear that God calls some to teach. Not everybody is called or gifted to teach. Okay? So I think what he's using this as an illustration. You should be far enough along in your faith that you should be able to teach these fundamental truths. You should know them so well that if somebody asks you, you should be able to give a reasonable answer. Okay? He's not calling all of us to teach. Okay? So if you've been looking at this going, oh man, I gotta teach, they're gonna put me in with the 2 to 4 year olds. That's not what this is. Okay? So continuing on, you need milk, not solid food. Ouch. Because at a certain point, your body is going to require something more than milk. In order to grow properly, to develop properly, you need to move beyond milk and to solid food. For everyone who lives on milk is unskilled in the word of righteousness, since he is a child. But solid food is for the mature, for those who have their power of discernment trained by constant practice to distinguish good from evil. You see, this isn't even the part of the message that I want to get to, but this is critical to us. Okay? I want to reread this last phrase here. Solid food is for the mature, for those who have their powers of discernment trained by constant practice to distinguish good from evil. We are all called to discern. There are those that are gifted with discernment that is beyond what the general of us would have. But all of us are called to be discerning, because we have got to be able to tell the difference between good and evil, between what is right and what is wrong, between what is righteous and what is profane. And I'll tell you the truth, it's not as easy as it sounds. Because the devil likes to appear as an angel of light. And he knows this word. Remember when Jesus was tempted in the desert? The devil quoted Scripture. You heard the phrase, the devil quoting Scripture to his own ends. See, that's something we have got to be afraid of, be cautious of, be wary of. Is those people who want to take the Scripture and manipulate it to say what they want it to say. And you'll hear this a lot. They'll couch it in phrases like, well, that was for them then, but that's not for us. Well, Scripture is very clear on what was for then and what is for us. Okay? It's very clear. And when we start to look through the lens of our culture or our time, the word is what becomes distorted. And so our faith is weakened and warped and no longer represents the true faith. So by constant practice, we learn to discern between good and evil, meaning we are always doing this. We're, everything that comes in, we take it, we examine it, we hold it up in the light of God's Word. I read an article this week. It was very interesting. This lady had come out of the lesbian lifestyle. And she was talking about how harmful it is that so many people in the church are embracing the homosexual movement. and she referred to a particular quote by a particular author and speaker, and this person has embraced that the homosexual lifestyle, those people are loved of God. Yes, they are loved of God. But their sin is not. Their sin is not acceptable before God, just like any sin is not acceptable before God. And see, the church has gotten so good at picking and choosing our particular sins that we like to confront these sins and just kind of sweep over these. And oh, Lord, can we preach against those people that practice homosexuality? But for those of us that like to overeat, we just brush it off. We like to preach against alcoholism and drugs, and we brush over gossip and rumor mongering. We like particular sins. We want to jump on the soapbox to particular sins and yet just leave others undealt with. But that's not what Scripture says. And so this lady was writing, and she said, you know, I was not saved out of lesbianism. I was saved out of sin. I was not restored unto a normal sexuality. I was restored to my Heavenly Father. And as a result of that process, that restoration, I had to determine, was I going to keep what I wanted, or was I going to let it go and take what he wanted? And see, every one of us, when we come to this point, we have got to make the same choice. Do I want to keep what I want? Am I negotiating with God? I will give up these. I will go this far. God, I'll give you 12.5%. But I want to keep 87.5%. Or are we even more righteous and say, God, 50-50. I'll give you half of what I got. But I want the other half. Because see, that's not how we come to him. We come to him via the cross. When you go to the cross, you give up everything. Everything. You've got to let it go. And one of the things that she said was, she was confronted with the idea, with the issue. Was she going to elect how she felt, and this is so critical, folks, how she felt, was she going to let that manipulate how she viewed or was viewed? Or was she going to hold her life up in light of the Scripture and allow God to tell her how she should appear? And she said, I had no choice. God's word tells me it's wrong. I've got to let it go. I've got to give it up. And see, the whole point is that we have got to be practicing discernment. We have got to be so familiar with this word that when something comes up that it doesn't sound right, we can go, whoa, 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 wait a minute. How does that stand in light of this? Because this is what God says. Let every man be a liar, but let God be truth. So let's go forward a little bit more. See, we're not even into the message yet, and I'm already excited. Okay, so by constant practice, distinguish good from evil. Therefore, because of what we've just read, let us leave the elementary doctrine of Christ and go on to maturity, not laying again a foundation of repentance from dead works and of faith towards God and of instructions about washings and laying on of hands, the resurrection of the dead and eternal judgment. And this we will do if God permits. Now I'm going to pause right there. I go any further and we're getting into a whole nother ball of wax. Okay, but we're going to deal with this right here over the next few weeks. These are the elementary doctrines that as a disciple of Christ, we should have knit within our very being. We should understand and be able to elucidate, to be able to explain what these positions are, what these doctrinal issues are. So today we are going to deal with repentance from dead works. Okay? Now, before I get into what I really want to share with you today, we have to have an understanding, because when the author of Hebrews was writing, now some people say the author was Paul. I don't think it was Paul. There are a lot of things in here that sound exactly like Paul. The way the phrases are constructed, the things that are said, it could be something that Paul just sat down and penned. But the majority of it is written in its own idiom, in its own language. So what I think is it was somebody who was intimately familiar with Paul, like Onesimus or Aristarchus or one of the others, who spent a lot of time under Paul's ministry and was taught by Paul. And that's why in some phrases, almost word for word, it says exactly what Paul says. But in other cases, probably not. I think it was probably someone that did not grow up as a Hebrew, or at least in a Hebrew learning place. Because oftentimes throughout the book, the writer will say, it says somewhere, and then they'll quote a scripture. Whereas if they had grown up in a Hebrew rabbinical teaching, they would know exactly who said it. And they would give reference to it. They took great pride on being able to point out particular passages. So I think it was someone maybe like Timothy, who had one parent that was Hebrew and the other that was not. And so he only got part of the teaching, okay? And is learned, but is not as learned. So the writer is going on and saying the elementary truths. And the first one that he does, he's writing to Hebrews. He says, repentance from dead works. Now, the original people that were receiving this, I believe, were probably people in the churches like Galatia or Rome, whom Paul had written letters to talk to them specifically about dead works. Okay? And the issue being that the recipients of this letter were Hebrews that had come to faith. And these were men and women who had been taught the law and had Paul intercede and intervene in their learning process and say, wait. Not one of you can attain righteousness by following the law, by obeying the law. Because there is no righteousness from the law, because if you break one part of the law, you have broken all of the law. And if you could attain righteousness by attaining the law, there would be no need for sacrifice. Okay? And so the writer of the book of Hebrews, when he writes this phrase, repentance from dead works, I think his original thought, he was thinking in the lines of Paul's teaching to the Jews, specifically in the book of Galatians, where he's saying, hey, look, you guys are practicing these things, and specifically circumcision, because you think that brings righteousness. But that doesn't bring righteousness. Righteousness is an issue of the heart. Paul calls it a circumcision of the heart. Okay? And so I believe that the author, originally writing with his physical mind and his limited capacity, he's writing a letter to the Hebrews, and he's wanting to address this issue again. Hey, look, you guys have been saved out of this, so there's no point in working to attain righteousness by the law, because you've attained a righteousness not your own. You have received a righteousness from God Himself. So what can you add to it? All those things that you're trying to do to make yourself righteous are for naught, because there's a righteousness better that is freely given to you. But we've got a problem, because who in here is Hebrew? Nobody? I got a little bit. But I wasn't trained in the Hebrew culture or the rabbinical teachings. I don't know much of the Talmud. But if God, who looking through the eons and the ages, saw us today, and he knew we needed this passage, and he knew also that we were not given the training of a Hebrew, why would he send this to us? Well, because we need it. Because we're not so unlike the Jews in that we somehow fall into the thinking that our good works will attain for us in some measure righteousness. We all get caught up in that. Oh, I can't do that because God wouldn't like that and I might be besmirched. I like that word, besmirched.
Cartoony.
Yes, cartoony. We all, in some measure, seek to earn our righteousness because we have a hard time accepting a free gift. We want to kind of pay back. We want to have something where we can say, well, you know, I worked for that. That our self-righteousness might, you know, we can pat ourselves on our back. But God gives us a righteousness not our own. And so when we're talking about this in the context of us Gentiles, what is repentance from dead works? Well, what are dead works? Anything that does not lead to life. Anything that is not directly in line with the will of God, done, I'll go you one further. Anything that is not done in faith. Paul writing to the Romans, he said, hey man, some of you celebrate specific days. And some of you celebrate all days equally. And some of you eat only particular foods. While others, hey, everything's good. So what does Paul say? If you are doing this in faith, whether you eat everything or little, whether you celebrate specific days or all days, if you do it in faith, you're good. But if you don't do it in faith, it is sin. So, what are dead works? Anything that is not leading to life. But I want to key in on one particular word. Now, keeping in mind that God's word, God's the theology that he gives to us, the doctrines that we have, they're not like this. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. They're like this. They're interdependent. Okay? You can't take one particular doctrine and separate it out from the rest without in some way diminishing the doctrine. Because they all depend on each other. What does the word say? Precept upon precept. Okay? They need each other for stability. And as such, we need to get out of this particular thing where we all have our pet doctrines. We all have those. We like those that we prefer. But we need to understand that they are interdependent. Thus, we need all of them. Okay? We've got to be firmly established in all of them. So, we're going to talk today about repentance. But I can't really talk about repentance without also dealing with, in some measure, faith. And I can't really talk about faith without dealing in some measure what we have faith in, or in this case, whom we have faith in. So we would then have to deal with the doctrine of God, a triune God. And then in order to understand the doctrine of a triune God, we've got to understand the person and the nature of God. And so, see how they all fit together. So what I'm going to try and do today is, with only touching lightly on these other doctrines that come together and help build and establish and hold firm the doctrine of repentance, I want to deal specifically with repentance. Okay? So, there are two Greek words used in Scripture for repentance. And this is critical because the first one, while it may lead you to salvation, is not what is needed unto salvation. Okay? So the first word, metamolamai, mai, excuse me. Okay? This idea is a feeling of remorse. To feel remorse. Now, while feeling bad, feeling remorseful can lead you unto salvation, left unto itself, without being merged with the second part of repentance, all it does is make you feel bad. Judas Iscariot. After he received the silver and he betrayed his Lord and he saw what was happening, he felt remorse. And he took the silver and he threw it on the temple grounds, and then he ran off and he hanged himself. Okay? He felt remorse, but it was not unto salvation. He felt bad. I know lots of people that feel bad about stuff. Oh, I know I shouldn't do that, but... Okay? So that idea of repentance is not unto salvation. It can lead to salvation, but left unto itself, it doesn't take you anywhere. Okay? Because us being the people that we are, one of two things will happen is you'll get into depression and everything stinks, and you never move out of that, or we just run off to the next exciting thing to cover it over and bury it. Okay? So, but the second word, actually the first word, Jesus wrote about this in Matthew, or spoke about this in Matthew 21, verse 28 through 32. I'm going to share this passage with you. It says, "What do you think? A man had two sons, and he went to the first and he said, 'Son, go and work in the vineyard today.' And he answered, 'I will not.'" I'm imagining this son must have been of age, because I can't imagine any of my sons being underage and I tell them to go do something and they go, "Nope. That didn't last long." Oh, really? This is not the age to assert your independence, because you still need me to feed you and clothe you and put a roof over your head. And then we sing the song, "He touched me." So I'm assuming that the children, these two sons, were of an age. "I will not." But afterward, he metamolamai, he changed his mind. He changed his mind. And he went. And the father went to the other son and said the same. And he answered, "I go, sir." But did not go. Now, I don't know, the second son, I don't know if he changed his mind or if he was just a liar. Or maybe he just got caught up in things and forgot. We don't have that explanation. But what I do know is that Jesus holds up the first son, who, even though he said no, he repented. He had a feeling of remorse. I know Dad's behind and he really needs help getting it done. And I know brother so-and-so, he ain't going to work. I better go do this. This is the son that is held up as an example of righteousness. Okay? Paul makes the same use of the word when he writes to the Corinthians, his second letter, which is actually, we believe, the third letter. He writes to them. And he's talking to them. He said, you know, he's sharing with them, I didn't want to grieve you, but I did want to grieve you because grief was necessary for you to change. And he says in chapter 7, verse 8 of 2 Corinthians, he says, "For even if I made you grieve with my letter, I do not regret it. I'm not filled with remorse. But I did regret it. I was filled with remorse. And I think what he's saying here is, excuse me, I didn't regret doing it because it was necessary. And obviously it was because you've changed. But I did regret it because I didn't want to hurt you. I didn't want to have to chastise you. But it was necessary. Because you were drifting away. You were being blinded. And I needed to. And for your sake, it was good that I did. But I didn't want to. I would rather that you acted properly the first place. So I wouldn't have to do this. So Paul uses the same word. I felt remorse that I had to do this. But I had to do it, so I don't feel remorse. Because it was necessary. But now we move to the second word. Metanoio. Okay? Metanoio. This word literally means you changed your mind. You changed your mind. See, this is the difference between a discussion and an argument. I have never seen anyone ever have their mind changed in an argument. Even if you know, Christy is the champion at this. I surrender. Do it your way. You're right. She's lying. She does not believe that I am right. She just wants to be done. Okay? But in a discussion, your mind is to the place where you can be persuaded. But man, when you argue, man, you are so firmly entrenched, I'm not going to move, you're not going to budge me. Oh, that's a really good argument. That would tear me down, but you know what? I'm going to put this block here, and now it's gone. And that's all that arguments do. They just allow you to become more firmly entrenched in your original position. But a discussion, that allows, if you're willing to actually hear what's being said, if you're willing to set down your pride for a moment, because isn't that really where it goes from being a discussion to being an argument? Is our pride gets in the way? Okay? On a discussion, if you can listen through and set your pride to the side, almost always you can reach an accommodation. You can adjust your positions to be on more level ground. So that both sides, neither side is getting exactly what they want, but in the art of compromise, both are happy and willing to settle with what they've got. Okay? So, the changing of your mind. Now, the first idea is that we feel remorse, but just feeling remorse does not necessarily lead us to the cross. But the second idea, the changing of your mind, the changing of your thinking, when dealing with issues like sin, and see, here we've got to insert another doctrine, confession. See, when you first come to a right understanding and your mind is changed about your position before a holy God, you turn your thinking to come into line with His thinking. And yeah, you know, before, during, or after, somewhere in there, there's got to be remorse. Because if you are truly convicted of sin and your unrighteousness, you cannot help but feel remorse before a perfect and a holy God. I have offended you. I have hurt you. I have done things that you oppose. I have separated myself from you. So somewhere in there is going to be remorse, but in that moment, it should be instantly changed to gratitude. Do you know that Scripture says that Jesus' sacrifice has not only done away with sin, but it's also done away with the guilt of sin? I know so many Christians that are walking around today with guilt. Now, I want to encourage you. Look, if the sin has been dealt with, if you have corrected whatever was off, okay, God has convicted you of a particular sin, and you have corrected it, don't dwell there any longer. Move from the remorse into the grace and the joy. Okay? So, to turn our mind, to turn our thinking, Jesus used this phrase, Matthew chapter 11, verse 20. He says, then he began to denounce the cities. We're talking about Bethsaida, Chorazin, and Capernaum, the cursed triangle up on the northern edge of the Sea of Galilee. This is where Jesus spent the first part of his ministry, going between these towns, preaching at their synagogues, and healing their sick, and doing miraculous signs and wonders. And yet it was in these places that they went, isn't that the son of the carpenter? Where does he get off teaching this kind of stuff? Where does he get off healing my kid? Who does he think he is? But that's the idea of what's going on there. People are looking and they're judging. I knew him, man. His dad had him help fix a table of mine, and that thing sat wobbly ever since. Where does he get off telling me that I'm not right? I don't think that happened. I don't think Jesus' tables would have been wobbly. I'd like to have one of his tables. That would be cool. Then he began to denounce the cities where most of his mighty works had been done. Why did he denounce them? Because they did not repent. They did not turn their thinking. Matthew chapter 12, verse 41. Jesus is speaking. He says, the men of Nineveh will rise up at the judgment with this generation and condemn it. For they repented at the preaching of Jonah. And behold, something greater than Jonah is here. Now you think about this. This is Nineveh. That God spoke to Jonah and he said, I need you to go and deliver my word to Nineveh because I'm going to destroy it. They become a stench in my nostril. I'm wiping them off the face of the earth. And we all know the story. You know, God said, go east, so Jonah went west. And God said, no, we've got an express route right back. Okay? And so Jonah goes and he goes through the city and it says that it took him 3 days to go through the city. And what happened? Now keep in mind, Nineveh was the capital of Babylon, okay? Capital of the Chaldeans. And this was a people that later, years later, God was going to curse. And he was going to, he even said, I'm going to level the city because of how they treated with his people. All right? But at this time, what happened? From the king down, the city repented. They got on their face before God and they turned their thinking. They went from, oh yeah, this is great, to, oh God, what have we done? And God relented in his anger and he spared them. Okay? I'm going to give you a number of passages. I would like you to look them up later. They're all in the book of Revelation. I'm just going to give you the particular passages right now, so jot them down quickly. Revelation chapter 2, verse 5. Actually, I'm going to go ahead and turn there so I can read them real quick to you. Jesus is speaking to the church at Ephesus, and he says, remember therefore from where you have fallen, repent, and do the works you did at first. If not, I will come to you and remove your lampstand from its place unless you repent, unless you turn your thinking. unless you come to that place where you realize you're wrong, I'm right. Repent. Chapter 2, verse 16. Now he's speaking to the church of Pergamum. He says, therefore, repent. If not, I will come to you soon and war against them with the sword of my mouth. Repent. Turn your thinking. Your thinking is twisted. It's wrong. Skipping forward yet again. Verses 21 and 22. Now he's speaking to the church at Thyatira. I gave her time to repent, but she refuses to repent of her sexual immorality. Behold, I will throw her onto a sick bed, and those who commit adultery with her, I will throw into great tribulation, unless they repent of her works. Repent. Turn your thinking. Moving forward again, chapter 3, verse 3, speaking to the church at Sardis. Remember then what you received and heard. Keep it and repent. If you will not wake up, I will come like a thief, and you will not know at what hour I will come against you. Verse 19, those whom I love, I reprove and discipline. So be zealous and repent. Skipping forward to chapter 9. Verse 20. The rest of mankind, now we're speaking about the trumpets, the rest of mankind who were not killed by these plagues did not repent. Now think about this. All these horrible things have come upon them. And they've seen it. And they've seen God move. And yet they still refuse. And they do not repent. Chapter 16, verse 9. You kind of get the feeling where I'm going here. They were scorched by the fierce heat. And they cursed the name of God, who had power over these plagues. They did not repent. Multiple times throughout the book of Revelation, there are several others that I'm not going to touch today. But the idea is that if you do not repent, if you do not change your thinking, you have set yourself opposed to God. I think about the book of Hebrews and the idea, the understanding that if you turn your back on God, the writer of Hebrews says, it is a fearful thing. It is a fearful thing. I think our church today deals too little with sin and repentance. I think we've become so accustomed to grace that we forget that grace is only received as a result of repentance. You can't be an inheritor of grace without repenting, without coming to that place where you turn your thinking to be in line with God's thinking. You can't repent without faith. You can't have faith unless you hear. You can't have faith unless you know whom you have faith in. We know from the all three of the synoptic gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, that the ministry of John the Baptist, he went out and he preached a baptism of repentance. Now I want to explain to you a baptism of repentance. That doesn't mean that when they got in the water, they were dirty, and when they came out, they were clean. No. Baptism of repentance is the baptism is a result of repentance. They repented first. See, the water has no power to cleanse the soul. Only God does. It's only the blood of Jesus that does that. But the baptism of repentance, the baptism is a public affirmation that you have repented. Now, interestingly enough, both Matthew and Mark say that when they repented, they also confessed. They confessed. See, that's something that our church absolutely shies away from. Oh, no, 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 no. We don't like confession. It makes everybody uncomfortable because you hear the sin of your neighbor. I don't want to know about their sin. I don't want them to know about my sin. Which is more important to you? The grace that you have received from God, a right standing, a right relationship with God, or the privacy of your sin? And what really drives the privacy of your sin? Isn't it pride? Isn't that also sin? Now, I'm not pointing the finger at you. We're all in this boat. I don't like people knowing when I mess up. That's uncomfortable. It's embarrassing. That's part of why I believe we have to have accountability partners, shield bearers, people that will walk alongside of us. And when we stumble, they will help us to our feet. People that we can trust that will come to us in love and say, hey, this is wrong. You can't do this. This is part of why I believe we have to be knitted into a body, a local fellowship at church, so that if you are too stubborn to listen to this partner, this one walking beside you, the church can get involved and help correct you. And people get so, it's none of their business. Well, that's like saying that your health care is not your doctor's business. And if you want the doctor to be of any use to you whatsoever, you got to tell him what's going on. Well, doc, when I walk, I get short of breath. Well, you know, how are you doing with your exercise? Are you keeping up with your... Oh, how dare you ask me that? No. I walk to the kitchen, get something to eat, and I walk back to my chair. But see, if you don't give them the information, they can't help you. And so many of us are bound up in our sin because we're afraid to confess. Drawing yourself into line with God. God, He wants to know how important this is to you. He wants to know how serious you are about this stuff. Because everything that God brings us through, the vast majority, it humbles us. It humbles us. He is trying desperately to break us of our pride that would keep us from entering fully in, to receiving His grace, to walking in the freedom that He has for us. Hey man, if everybody knows every little dirty secret on you, nobody can get anything on you, can they? Yeah, I blew it. You know what? I had a temper tantrum the other day. I blew it. Nobody can come and go, aha! Well, yeah, aha for you. The entire church knows. You got nothing on me. Repentance. You have to be first aware. First, have your thinking changed as regards to sin. And then allow God's Spirit to move you into that repentance where you find God's forgiveness. Man, if you don't repent, He will not forgive. Father, we thank You today. Father, that You are faithful to meet us where we are. Father, You have never said to us, go, except that You give us the strength and You walk with us, that You take us there. You have never put us in a place where You did not stand beside us. We thank You, Father, that You are rich in mercy. that Father, when we stumble, your word says that if we confess our sins, you are faithful and just to forgive us our sins. But Father, we thank you today, because without you, we'd be lost. We would be a dead people without hope. We honor you this morning, Father, in Jesus' name. Amen.